Houston, what's the story with this burn?
We're trying to hash something out down here, Aquarius. Stand by.
Well, now look, Houston, all we need to hold attitude is one fixed point in space. Is that not correct?
Yeah, roger that, Jim.
Well, Houston, we've got one. If we can keep the Earth in the window, flying manually, the coax
crosshairs right on its terminator. All I have to know is how long do we need to burn the engine?
The shorter the better.
Roger that, Jim.
Can they fly it manually and still shut it down on time without the computer?
I guess that's the best we can do, Glenn. We're out of time.
They're gonna burn the engines and steer it manually, attempting to keep the Earth in the window.
Okay, this is gonna take all three of us. Fredo, you handle the pitch, but on the translation controller. It's all backwards, so if the Earth starts drifting down, you need to thrust aft, not forward. I'll do the same online with everything else. We're gonna burn a 10% thrust for 39 seconds. Jack, you time us?
Got it.
Give us a count of the last 10 seconds up to 39, and let's not miss this.
You up to this, Fredo?
I'm with you.
Standing by for corridor control burn.
Okay, Jim, you can fire when ready.
You are go for the manual burn.
X plus button at 10 seconds. Mark.
Come on, baby. One
more
burn.
8, 7, 6, 5, 4.
I'll let just go.
2, 1.
She's burning.
Oh, yeah.
Pass your arm off.
Okay, here we go.
Unit regulator's on.
RTS is go 10% thrust.
Bring it around, Fredo.
I'm trying, but it's dragging.
10 seconds.
Alright, drop it down, Fredo. We're drifting.
No, you hold what you got. I'll roll it.
Back off.
God, I can't get it stable.
She's dancing all over the place.
Come to the right a little bit.
15 seconds.
She dripped in. I'm losing attitude.
Okay, hold it right there. That's it. Back. No,
Fredo. Back. That's it. Hold it.
40, steady, 9, shut down. Houston, we have shut down.
That's close enough, Jim. Good work.
Knew it! Knew it! How about that limb, huh? How about it?
Guess you can keep your job.
You betcha.
We've reached a part in our study in 1 Thessalonians where everything kind of shifts. Chapters 1 through 3, Paul is looking back. Chapters 4 and 5, he's looking forward. Chapters 1 through 3, he's talking about history. Chapters 4 and 5, he's talking about the future, what the future will look like for the Thessalonians. In chapters 1 through 3, it's so important because what Paul is dealing with is attitude. Now, different parents discipline their children for different reasons. I had always made it a policy in my raising of the 5 kids, and by the time we got to the 5th one, we almost had it figured out. But one of the things I did is I focused on attitude. John Maxwell says it this way: your attitude determines your altitude. Attitude is huge. And my kids, there were times when they would do something wrong, but they did it with a good attitude. But when they knew it was wrong, they didn't get quite the discipline they might have gotten. But I always tried to. There were times where my punishment might have seemed over the top a little bit because I connected it with their attitude. Their attitude is what I wanted to correct. Their attitude is what I wanted them to know was important. And Paul deals in chapters 1 through 3 with the past meeting with them. Why would he do that? Why would he spend 3 chapters essentially defending himself, talking about what they had gone through? I think it has to do everything with attitude. Because if people pressuring them from outside the church, if they were saying things like, look, Paul was only in this for the money, if they were saying things like, Paul left you, he's not coming back, You're an idiot for believing what Paul said. If they could undermine Paul in some way and affect the Thessalonians' attitude towards Paul, then they would have undercut his authority. There's nothing that he could say to them that they would take seriously about the decisions and choices they would need to make. And so in chapters 1 through 3, we look back, and it's a personal reflection about suffering, about what they went through, about Paul's heart and his heart desire. I wanted to come to you. And we said, we looked at that, about how there was a bond put up, and Jason and some other wealthy Thessalonians put a bond up. We're going to turn a corner now, because all of the past now, what about the future? And Paul's going to give them some instruction, and some of the things he's going to remind them of what he's told them previously when he was with them. Remember, he was only with them, the shortest length of time that he was with them was 3 weeks. It could have been as long as 6 to 8 weeks. I have a friend of mine who thinks it was 3 months. I don't think it was nearly that long. I think it was closer to 6 weeks. And the reason people think it was, 3 months or 8 weeks or so is simply because of the amount of information that the Thessalonians had and the establishment of that church against all odds. I mean, I was thinking about it this week, Montgomery Ward, Sears and Roebuck. I can remember in 1985 when Gail and I walked into our first Walmart. I said, oh, this is a cool store. This was in Texas, in Mesquite, Texas. This is a pretty cool store. Wonder if this will catch on. And in 1985, if you told me, okay, Rod, you can invest a dollar in Sears and Roebuck, Craftsman Tools, it's been here a while, or a dollar into Walmart, which one would you invest in? There's no question. But little do we know the future. And the fact of the matter is that church, against incredible odds, thrived and survived. And today there is a Christian witness in this city, and there has been since about 50 AD. There's been that Christian witness. So let's turn the page and let's go to the second half of the book. And the Apostle Paul wants to, this is a very practical section. In fact, I call this prioritizing pleasing God. Prioritize pleasing God. Here's what he says in chapter 4, verses 1 and 2. That's right. What he says going into this, go back one slide. Yeah. He said everything he said in chapter 3, that he may establish your hearts without blame in holiness before our God and Father at the coming of our Lord Jesus with all his saints. So the point is, his prayer is he wanted their hearts to be established without blame. Now he's going to talk about how to do that. What does it mean, and how do we go about establishing our hearts without blame? He goes to chapter 4 and verse 1, and here's what he says. Finally then, brethren, we request and exhort you. So we're asking you to consider, and we're encouraging you. Now, Paul could have demanded, I demand you, or I command you to do this. But he's not doing that. He's making a request, and he's making an encouragement to them. There's another little thing I want to point out as we go through this section. It says, finally then, brethren. This is the New American Standard. Some of your translations, I think maybe the NIV has, finally then, brothers and sisters. There's a debate. The debate is not so hot now. It was probably about 20 years ago, about language and then the use of language, and specifically as it referred to male and female in the Bible. It was the culture of that day when they said, brethren. You kind of understood that it wasn't just men, it was men and women. But there became a time when the translators said they were going to make that decision for you. In other words, when we're translating, we're going to decide for you if this should be men or if it should be men and women. If it should be the Christian family, the church family of men, or if it should be men and women. I don't agree with the NIV here. I think what he's about to talk about, and I'll try to prove that, and maybe I won't, but I think he's talking to the men here. It isn't that this doesn't apply to the women, But I think specifically in that day and time, the topic he's going to talk about is specifically directed to men. So you can kind of dodge and kind of, you know, do kind of like the Matrix thing where you're going back and all. But this hits guys square in the face. Okay, just make that comment. You don't have to agree with me. There's a lot of scholars that don't. But he says, finally, brethren, we request and exhort you that as you receive from us instruction. So he had spent some time with them and had instructed them on how to live, on about how you come into a relationship with Christ. You do that through faith because of what Christ has done, because of how God stood in the middle between God and man. Jesus stood in the middle, and how he not just covered sin, but he washed it away. He paid for the sin debt. So that as you receive from us instruction as to how you ought to walk and please God, how you ought to live and make God happy. And he says, just as you actually do walk, you're doing these things, and he'll tell them that you do more of what you're doing. You're doing well. Keep doing it. He's going to say that twice in the passage we cover this morning. Excel at it more. Now, how do you walk? How do you live and please God? What decisions, what attitude do you have that allows God to say, that a boy, that a girl? How do you bring a smile to God's face? And he said, these are the instructions on how you ought to please God. And I think the focus here is simply this. You need to live for an audience of one. Make it your desire to live for an audience of one. He goes on and he says this. He said, for you know what commandments we gave you by the authority of the Lord Jesus. For this is the will of God, your sanctification. Big word, your sanctification simply means you're set apart. Because you have now come into the family of God, because you've received eternal life. And when does eternal life begin? When you receive it. You've received eternal life. You've been set apart. God had as his desire for the nation of Israel that they would be unique, that they would be special, that they, out of all the nations in the world, they would be unique and special. They would be holy. They would be set apart. And so what he wants is for them to be set apart. And he wants the priority to be pleasing God. In Galatians 5:10, I believe it is, Paul says this. He says, am I still trying to please men? And I think the reason he says that is because there was a time when Paul lived his life to try to please other people, whether it was his teachers, whether it was people around the crowd around him. And he argues that his priority now is to please God. He's the only one that he wants to please. He wants to please God. So I think the first thing that Paul would tell the Thessalonians is to make it a priority to please God. Make God your number one priority. You know, sometimes people live their lives and they're trying to please other people. It's, I can never please you. I can never please you. Well, no, you can't. If I am sitting there praying, Lord, help a certain college team win. And you are sitting there praying, Lord, don't help that team in Kentucky win, you know. You're praying for one team. I'm praying for another. God's not going to please us both. Personally, I don't think God cares, but, you know, he's not going to please us both. But we have got it in our mindset, in our culture, that we can please everybody. You will run yourself crazy. You will be certified to check into the insane asylum if you try to please everyone. You should try to focus on pleasing God. That comes in a little bit more in a fuller view. If you get this right, if you say my priority is to please God, there are people, I can remember, I went from a very strong, fundamental Christian college to a secular college. And I can remember guys driving up on the forklift at work and they said, you are so out of God's will. And they just can't bang, you know, just, they said, you don't know what you're doing. You just... I can remember one night, Gail and I, we'd gotten tickets to Chicago, not to go to the city, but to hear the band. And I had a guy, you know, he came up to me, he says, you are so far out of God's will. I said, why? They're going to do Saturday in the park. You know, they're going to do just you and me. They're going to. But people have made it their priority. And I could have a choice there. I could either try to please them or I could do what I knew God had called me to do. And I could look back years later and say, God, you were guiding all of that. Even though other people didn't understand, I was following you. He goes on, and the second thing he says is control yourself. Just control yourself. Look at what he says in 3 through 8. He says this. He says, that is that you abstain, this is the will of God being set apart, that you abstain from sexual immorality, that each of you know how to possess his own vessel in sanctification, in set apartness, and in honor, not in lustful passion like the Gentiles who do not know God. So this is why I think this is directed mainly to men here. Now, there's some argument in some translations. I don't know if you have the translations, but there's some argument that you know how to possess your own vessel. What's a vessel? You think of a vessel as a boat. A boat is to get you from one place to another, unless you're fishing, and then it's just to get you to one place. And you don't care if you come back or not, as long as you get the fish. But that vessel is a container for something. And some people interpret this as the wife, that you possess your own wife. I don't know where that's coming from, but it's in some of your translations might have that. What he's talking about here, and I think it's just very clear, control your own body. Control yourself. You know, when you're sitting there and you're eating the 10th ice cream sandwich after supper, learn to control yourself. Back it down to 9 or 8 even. The fact of the matter is, you know, why would we want to try to control other people when we can't even control ourselves? And here he's talking about sexual appetite here. In that culture, women had virtually no say in this. In fact, when you read secular writers from that day, they said, look, getting married is just kind of so you can have children, and that's it. But rampant sexual exploitation was just huge. Sex slavery. In fact, I've shown you pictures of Thessalonica that they discovered back in the 90s. And back in 2010, there was an argument because they wanted to build some subways in the city, and they've hit all these archaeological discoveries. They have discovered right outside the marketplace these we'll call them brothels, if you will. And then they've discovered holding cells where they would keep women chained for this purpose. And everybody thought, well, yeah. I mean, it's just commonplace. And then Paul's telling the Thessalonians, no, you be different. You be focused on pleasing God. Don't live like the Gentiles. The Gentiles, the only thing they follow is their passion, their lust, their passion. They don't have anybody directing them. Because he says they don't know God. In our video clip, Apollo 13, they needed a fixed point to focus on. And on that fixed point, they could then move out and they could get the right direction. They needed a fixed point. You and I need a fixed point. Let me ask you this. If your fixed point is the current morality of the culture, it's going to be different in just a few years from now. Heck, a few months from now. There's a thing in our culture, they're canceling. They're ending people's jobs, and whether it's comedy or whatever. Things that used to be okay to say now aren't okay to say. Things that are okay to wear or wave or whatever, say, 10 years ago are no longer okay. The morality of today changes with the wind. I'm going to say something that's going to really get me in trouble. I sent a friend of mine, a guy friend, the cover of the newest Playboy. If you haven't seen that, when's the last time you thought you'd hear a preacher say that? Things are changing, and they are changing fast. And if you don't have a fixed point, and if that fixed point is not on pleasing God, then you're going to be out of luck. It's just a matter of time. Something else is going to come through. He goes on in verse 6. He says, and that no man transgress and defraud his brother in the matter, because the Lord is the avenger in all these things. God watches, God sees. Just as we told you before and solemnly warn you, for God has not called us for the purpose of impurity. That's not why God called us. He called us for sanctification, to set apart. So Paul would tell the Galatians, in your walk, I'm writing you these instructions so it will affect your walk and how you please God. And control your body. You tell it where to go. You tell it what to eat. You tell it what to see. Control your own body. You're responsible. With my kids, I have this talk. I said, hey, you know, where you end up will be because you are the one that drove there. Because in this culture, nobody's responsible for where they are. Well, it was my mama or my daddy, or it was because I was poor, or this week a shooting happened. It's because I was teased because I was rich. You know, it's a whole victim society. You control yourself. Because I took my kids once to prison. We stood outside the prison. And I said, you don't want to control your body? You don't want to control what comes out of your mouth? These guys, they don't have to worry about that. Somebody tells them when to get up. Somebody tells them when to go to bed. Somebody tells them what they're going to eat. They don't have to control everything. Somebody's telling them everything. You've got control. And if you don't enforce that, if you don't exert that, then you can only blame yourself. Do you think athletes, you know, when you go out for basketball, they end up running you for a week. And you're sitting there and you know, hey, I thought I was going out for basketball, not track and field. But you go out, they finally give you a basketball. Do you think people find that fun? Why do athletes do the things they do? They go over the desire. You know, my desire, it's like I showed you last week when Ray Williams, you know, what can you do well? I can lay on the ground real well. You know, that's my talent. What can you do with that? You can just sit back and not do anything. But when you put forth an effort and when you go forward, the fact of the matter is you end up controlling your body. But then he goes on. So he who rejects this is not rejecting man, but the God who gives his Holy Spirit to you. So if you say, hey, look, I think Rod's okay guy, but you know, he needs to keep his morality to himself. That's his opinion. Trust me, I've been doing this over 32 years, pastor. Boy, have I heard that more than one time. People have said, well, Rod, that's just your opinion. I'm going to start preaching now. I had somebody asked me, would I do a wedding? This was back when I would do weddings outside of the church. I no longer do that, okay? And somebody asked me, they said, will you do this well? I said, well, I'll talk to them. And I was talking to this couple, and I was talking about, you know, marriage is hard. Marriage is hard. And I said, you know, there's going to be some things that get on your nerves, and there's going to be some things that get on her nerves and things like that. And she interrupted me. She said, oh, we won't have that problem. We've lived together for 7 years. And I stopped right there and I said, look, you might think that's helpful, but that actually puts you at a disadvantage. And she and him snickered. No lie. They snickered. Okay. That's old Rod and his morality thing going on. I did the wedding. And about 6 months later, the person told the person in the church, Rod is a prophet. Rod's brilliant. How does Rod know all this? Rod ain't smart. Rod's really not smart. Rod just lived long enough to where, you know, when you see this thing hit the wall, and then a person comes up, I ain't gonna hit the wall. Oh, yeah, hit the wall, yeah. So what he's saying here is that, look, the Gentiles, all they're led by is their lust. But you, Thessalonians, you are led by God. God has given you his Holy Spirit. You have a choice. They're not making a choice if you want to argue it that way. They just don't know any better. But you have a choice. You're rejecting if you say, well, that's just Rod. That's just some old text in the Bible. You're not rejecting a denomination or religion. You're rejecting God. And you've got to realize God wants the very best for each and every one of us. Now, let me put it this way. A fire in a fireplace is warm, is romantic. A fire in a fireplace is just wonderful for a home. But you take that fire outside of that fireplace and it'll ruin the home. Okay? Just remember that. Just remember that. All right. Well, he goes on and he says this. There's one other thing I want to say. When the temptation that you face, when that temptation is in the area of desire, you want something, run, flee. When the temptation is in the area of discouragement, oh, I hate this job, or I'm just getting so discouraged doing kids' work, or I'm just getting so, you stand. Because what we usually do is we do the opposite. When the area of temptation is desire, we say, okay, how close can I get to this without crossing that line? And when the area is discouragement, we just quit. We just flee. We run. The Bible tells us to flee the desire temptation and instead stand in the discouragement temptation. Well, he goes on and he says, let love be your ambition. Let love be the thing you pursue. Now, as to the love of the brethren, you have no need for anyone to write to you, for you yourselves are taught by God to love one another. For indeed, you do practice it toward all the brethren who are in all Macedonia. Remember in chapter 1, he says, all the brothers in Macedonia here tell about you. They are caring for one another. Remember, they have been isolated from society. They're not in a religion, an accepted religion now. They've been blackballed. The people have turned their backs. There's probably people have lost their jobs. They are coming together to encourage one another, to provide for one another. But he says, but we urge you, brethren, to excel still more. This whole thing about loving one another, and what does it mean? What does that practically look like? I think it looks like celebrating with people when they have a victory and weeping with people when they have a loss. So you should make love your ambition. And then he goes on and he says this in verse 11, and make it your ambition to lead a quiet life and attend to your own business. Mind your own business. Mind your own business. How much energy do we spend? Remember, if you're not trying to please God, don't do this. If you're not trying to please God, do whatever you want with your body. You can talk smack about anybody, especially the preacher. You can get involved and all worked up about what other people are doing. You can be like Mrs. Kravitz, you know, on Bewitched, always looking across the street. That was her entertainment. He says, mind your own business. Attend to your own business. Lead a quiet life. Do you know how many people don't like that? Why would I want to lead a quiet life? They always want stress and they always want excitement and they always want things just always going on. Wow, how can you live like that? He says, just as we commanded you. And you do that so that you will behave properly toward outsiders and not be any need. Win the respect of others. Act in a way that other people, not that they might agree with you, but they respect you. Right? I don't know. Why would you live that way? Why would you make those choices? Because, see, I am the guy that hates pain. When it came to baseball, I would stand as far away out of that batter's box. That plate was over there. And I would say, you throw it over there. Because I have been hit by the ball and I hate pain. And these warnings are not because God likes to punish you. It's because of what God wants for you. What he wants in your marriage. What he wants in your home. What he wants in your life. This is how to prioritize pleasing God. And he does that even as it affects outsiders. Here's the bottom line. Be different enough to be attractive to those who don't agree with you. Live your life with something in focus, not the world in focus, but a God who loves you, and he went to Calvary's cross for you. He's done everything he can for you so that you could have the type of life and the kind of life that others will respect. So prioritize pleasing God. Any other way you work that, Paul would tell the Thessalonians, it's going to be trouble. It's going to be trouble. Are you going to reject me? No, I'm not going to reject you, but I'm going to be here. Are you going to say, I told you so? Probably. Probably. But it just amazes me how people play a different game. It amazes me. People think they can do things and make decisions and there are no consequences. There are always consequences. Prioritize pleasing God. You get that right, everything else will go a lot easier. That was Paul's desire for the Thessalonians. It's his desire for each and every one of us. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your love that has given over and over again, demonstrated the depths you would go through for each and every one of us. May we prioritize your love in our lives. May we prioritize our ambition of pleasing you and walking in a way that brings a smile to your face. For it's in Christ's name I pray. Amen. Amen.